First of all, congratulations on saving the Green Line extension. It's a great effort and a successful outcome, and all of you that were involved in it deserve a lot of credit for it. I would urge that you take some of the lessons you learned from that and apply it to the Alston interchange. I think some of the most important things you did with the Green Line after the sticker shock was to take a very close look at constructability issues, making sure that you created the conditions to allow some contractors to bid competitively. And it's a great success because you got those numbers down. What I've read so far in the draft environmental impact report in Alston leads to a lot of alarm that the same kinds of problems that were embedded in the original flawed Green Line approach are embedded in that, and I would call your attention to just a few of them. One, the constructability issues are described in some detail for the three alternatives for the throat, but there's no detailed description of constructability for the no-build. I think the no-build is a disaster. I don't think it's buildable. The document does not explain how it could be built. There's some words, but there's no graphics. You can like whichever of the options you prefer among the throat options. I personally prefer the ABC. But all three have a description in the graphics so you can get an understanding of the level of difficulty in constructing them. The viaduct plan includes a phase when the single track over 50 years, the Western rail car has been confined to a single track. That's one of the reasons it's always had the worst on-time performance of any of the commuter rail operations. The walkthrough on constructability shows that single track constraint being restored. We've had a couple of years of two-track operations where the ridership is better, the service is better. That's all the public transportation access from the west to Yawkey, a lot of which goes to Longwood Medical. Reimposing the single track constraint is a big problem. It may be necessary, I'm not questioning that. This is a very tough thing to build in a very constrained area. You have not had a layup facility on the Western Corridor ever. I question the need for it, but you certainly don't need it now when you're about to start a very difficult construction project, where you need much more than lay up for commuter rail is lay down area for the contractor who somehow, when you choose a design builder to do this, has got to build a very complicated thing. All three of the options in the throat are tough builds. I like the IBC better because I believe it is more buildable, but all three are very tough to build. If you don't give the design build operator some lay down area, there's no chance you're going to get reasonable bids on it. I believe, as a consequence of the single track, and that may be optimistic, there may be periods where we have to shut it all together, not because we want it, but because it's very tough to build in that area. I think you need an interim west station at the very front end of this project so that rail commuters from the west have the option of transferring onto bus service down in Oliver to get over to Longwood Medical. This is going to be a miserable place to get through. And if it's miserable for the commuters, it's going to be even more miserable for the neighbors because people are going to be all over Alston and Brighton trying to escape the congestion that's going to occur. Not because you're bad people, not because you want to drive people nuts, but because it's a very tough construction project. So I think that those constructability issues really have to be looked at very carefully. The other thing that I would commend you on as a board is that you've started a study of how to turn the commuter rail asset into a regional rail system like they have in Europe. I've seen what they've done in London, where they've converted some really lousy commuter rail operations into some very high quality, nearly rapid transit quality systems that they call London Overground. I think that's a very exciting direction. The draft environmental impact report that I've been reading, it's 600 pages, so I won't claim to have read it all, but I've read, I think, the critical parts. It includes some poison pills that will make it very difficult to do that even before you get launched with your consultant study of how to do that. Because it, for example, in one option, leaves out the reconstruction of the Grand Junction little bridge over Soldiers Field Road. The Grand Junction, you may know, goes over the Charles River, but then it goes down and under the current viaduct. Doing particularly the viaduct scheme and not fixing that bridge and then coming back afterwards to fix that is incredibly inefficient. While you've got the contractor in there, it's an 85-year-old bridge, it's physically very close to the construction. It's going to be much more difficult to do later. It ought to be done before. And if you don't have the building blocks that allow you to do a regional rail approach, this is your best opportunity to think through what regional rail would be like. Historically, I am an old man. I've lived in Brighton 75 by 77 years. There used to be a six-track railroad through Brighton. When the Western Corridor Rail was built, the one to Worcester, it included intercity rail, suburban rail, and urban rail. We had, in Alston Brighton, four stations within a mile of each other. Alston Depot that now sells Regina Pizza, the Market Street that doesn't exist, Brook Street that was taken away from us, and Newton Corner that's no longer there. So we lost all of our rail service in Brighton. Newton retained marginal rail service because of that single track constraint, but Newton retained three stations a mile apart. Wellesley retained three stations a mile apart. Now, I'm not being anti-suburban here. My sister lives in Newton and uses commuter rail to go to work. My son lives in Wellesley and uses commuter rail to go to work. But the density of housing in Wellesley is much smaller than the density of housing in Newton. The density of housing in Newton is much smaller than the density of housing in Alston today. And with all the development coming into Alston and Brighton, it's not even close. Yet the draft EIR implies that we don't deserve two stations in Brighton when we used to have four. That's absurd. It also totally ignores that the whole point of West Station is to serve as a regional distributor for Western commuters who are coming in, who aren't all the way to downtown. They're going to Longwood Medical, they're going to Kendall. So this is your best chance to try out the ideas of what it would take to make a regional rail. And you don't want to kill that before the opportunity begins. I'll say one thing about funding. Most of the rail renovation required for all of the options are required in order to do the highway project. So other than layout, which I think is something that if it happens at all should happen at the very end, the last thing you need are commuter trains wandering into this construction zone through the whole time. You don't need that added complexity. With the exception of that, all the other rail moves are mostly required in order to do the highway project. You cannot revise the eastbound turnpike alignment, which is required in all three options. You cannot do that without first moving the rail service to the far south. After you've done the highway, you've got to move that rail service back. I believe you need a West Station interim as a way of rerouting some of the passengers. Those requirements are caused by the disruptiveness that rebuilding that piece of highway is going to cause. Again, not because you want to be disruptive, but because it's an extremely tough construction job. I don't think the draft EIR reflects the lessons you've learned in the Grand Junction, and I don't think it anticipates the opportunities you're looking for in the regional rail. So with that, I really appreciate your letting me speak, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. And obviously, I think we're going to hear a lot more about that also.